Hello, 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 and welcome to Web of Light. This is the show where we support and promote those individuals, companies, and nonprofits that are weaving a web of light in the world. I want to welcome some of the new stations we just picked up. Unfortunately, we don't get your exact call letters or anything, but we now are in California. We come over to New Jersey, and we've got stations that are airing us all the way up to Vermont. If we haven't mentioned your area of the country or your city, again, I don't even always get the cities, please send me an email at drkevin, D-R-K-E-V-I-N, at weboflight.com so that I can make sure I formally welcome you to the Web of Light show. So, as promised last week, myself and my lovely co-host, again, I'm Dr. Kevin, and then we have Angie. You know, we just got Mrs. Partridge back from Kentucky, where she was taking care of one of her baby partridges, and now she's had an emergency. So I guess you're just stuck with me again. Oh, well, this country's been stuck with a lot worse, especially lately. Not that I'm going to go there. It's not that show. Though we will be having a show, keep your eyes open, called Surviving a Trump Presidency. Surviving a Trump pregnancy. Well, I wonder what he's going to give birth to. Whatever it is, it's probably not going to be good. But anyway, surviving a Trump presidency. So keep your eyes open for that. So in a moment, I am going to just be introducing today's guest. But before that, we always start with words of wisdom. Whether Miss Angie is here or not, we still start with words of wisdom. So here we are seeing this. You're seeing this going into the last week of December, January changeover. So we have New Year's Eve coming. We'll talk about that a little bit at the end of the show and maybe some things that you might want to think about going into the new year. But right now, I'm going to share a poem with you. Now, oftentimes you hear me, Angie and I trade some quotes, and oftentimes I'll read some of my poetry, especially if I feel it's appropriate to the guest or our conversation for the day. This poem I'm sharing with you now is actually my aunt's. My aunt was an award-winning poet. She won Maine Poet of the Year. She won New England Poet of the Year. She got several books published in her lifetime. Part of the genetics of me being a poet myself. So today's quote or poem is called Church Nursery Closed, All Toys Confiscated. So run, Charlie, run. In a corner of Lane Hall, obsolete until the fall, are trucks with wheels that cannot spin when you're locked out and they're locked in. So run, Charlie, run, and kick a stone, throw a stick, and run on home. Freckled face, tousled hair, a piece of thyme, who would dare? Twine, who would dare? With wheels to turn and dreams to spin, lock you out, leave them in. Trucks to wheel through mud, through sand. Guess you'll never understand why adults with prissy air harp about a nursery toy, object of a little boy. So run, Charlie, run, and kick a stone, throw a stick, and run on home. Again, that was by my aunt, Glennis May Emery, who had several books out in her lifetime of poetry. So, you know, I'm going to get ready to introduce today's guest, but oftentimes we forget how much our adult logical decisions affect a child. A child who would just like to play, would like to have a truck or a doll or a sand house or maybe even just a mud puddle. And yet we forget sometimes. We forget what it's like to be a child. Sometimes we forget that the best childhoods are the ones that are filled with imagination and experiences. They're not found on iPads or computers. They're not found in front of TVs. The best childhoods are found by those that get to throw a stick, throw a stone, get their feet wet, hang out in nature, and maybe play with a truck. Better to play with a truck than watch trucks getting blown up in some abstract reality that exists beyond a piece of glass. Today's guest is Eva Goulette. She is the founder of Dancing Jaguar Inspirations. Their mission, using a mixture of ancient traditions, nature experiences, and modern holistic techniques, Dancing Jaguar Inspirations assist in the development of well-rounded, empowered children who are connected to their authentic self by providing them with educational experiences that nurture their minds, bodies, and spirit. So I'm getting ready. I'm not done. They offer services like Spirit Camp. Spirit Camp is a 5-day summer program for children, ideal for children ages 5 to 10. Spirit Camp offers children a myriad of ways to explore, express, and honor spirit. They give original spiritual tools developed by Dancing Jaguar to bring teaching and practices from the program into your house and family life. They also curate products developed by other well-known spiritual teachers. And their goal is, we seek to empower children. Now, there's one of my favorite words. You, my audience, my faithful audience knows how much I love the word empower. We seek to empower children to connect to their authentic self through a mix of ancient traditions, nature experiences, and modern holistic techniques. What? I don't see any video games listed. There's no iPad. There's no watching endless nonsensical violence on TV. That's not listed. Well, we're going to have a word with Eva. And it doesn't say anything about feeding them like Lucky Charms or Captain Crunch. I don't know. So anyways, Eva, welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Kevin. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, you know, we're glad to have you. I actually wore these pants in honor of you.
Wonderful. They're so playful.
I know. And if you, I don't know if you can read it. Meditation, a brain vacation.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yes. Mantra light with reading Om and Garden.
Om and Garden. That's really cute.
Om and Garden. So, Eva, you know, I know that I'm leading right into your favorite subject, and we're going to talk about a lot of stuff you do, but what did you think of the poem?
That was a beautiful poem. Your aunt, you said, right?
Yes.
Yes, that was beautiful. Well, I think that in today's society, children are so used to playing with things and having entertainment from things that are not in their best interest in terms of their health and their creativity, their imagination. And I think just getting a child out in nature and running and playing and picking up sticks and learning about gravity by jumping into puddles and seeing what happens. I mean, to me, that's much more exciting than a child just learning from watching a video game or playing on a computer.
So, you know, oftentimes adults are making decisions not understanding how they're impacting children. Do you find that a lot of times that you are getting children who are being negatively impacted because of accident, by carelessness? And I don't mean intentional carelessness, but a lack of ability to perceive what the child's world is.
Mm. Yes, as a matter of fact, I think that oftentimes parents are so wrapped up in their world that they forget to take a step back and see the world through the eyes of their child. So oftentimes decisions are made based on what the adults are seeing and aware of and are aware of in their world, but it has a really different effect on a child and the child's world. So for me, it's really important to work with parents as well. So parents can approach these decision-making processes they go through with their children from a more conscious place, a more aware place. So the effects of any decision on a child will be thought about prior to making the decisions.
And those effects henceforth will become more positive.
Yes.
Or are likely to become more positive. I know that when I work with families and do multi-generational things, a lot of times, sometimes parents get it. They'll come in and they'll say to me, I need help learning how to parent this child. But a lot of times they come in wanting me to fix the child. And I go, well, I don't know that it's about fixing the child, but I can give the child some tools and skill sets. But the best thing I'll give the child is better parents when we're done.
That's really good. And are most parents open to hearing that?
By the time they hit me, they usually are. You know, a lot of my practice is word of mouth. Mm-hmm. People don't are not going to get recommendations to come see me usually from their traditional school counselor, mm-hmm. Or their traditional medical doctor, who are very tied up in a medical model. Mm-hmm. And so that's not going to, you know, I'm the guy that says, you know, let's talk diet, let's talk tools, let's talk skill sets. Let's talk about broadening education to be more inclusive. Let's talk about parenting that isn't just a byproduct of the bad parenting you had.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, yeah, but by the time they reach me, usually they are. Mm. So, you know, this show often talks about spirit, God, goddess, Allah, Buddha, Great Pumpkin, mm-hmm. one of my favorites.
Glinda the Good Witch of the North was one of mine. Oh. I had her on this goddess pedestal for years when I was growing up.
Yeah, and see, and I always liked Elzebub. especially after seeing Wicked. I actually am going to be teaching this winter coming up a class I teach called Learning Everything You Need to Know About Life You Can Learn Through a Broadway Musical.
Oh, that's great. So that would be fun.
All Broadway songs from like the 20s up to current that teach life lessons and inspiration. So back to spirit.
Yes.
You have something that you call a spirit camp. Now, there is spirit, like having the old college spirit. There is spirit, that which is the connecting energy of all of us. There is spirit as in high energy. So when you talk about a spirit camp, define mm-hmm. spirit for me, Eva.
Well, I believe in our society that children are nurtured in terms of their mind and their body, but not necessarily their spirit. We are made up of mind, body, spirit. And for me, a true, balanced, authentic, empowered person has a balance between their mind, body, and spirit. And with our society and the way we're raising children to be nurtured for their mind and their body, but not their spirit, I feel like the children are not growing up to be really holistic, well-rounded, empowered, authentic individuals. So I started working to create products and programs that would help a child understand that they are also made up of spirit. So the programs that I've developed and the curriculum I've developed help a child tap into their own spirit. They learn how to nurture their spirit. And then we learn about connecting to everything around us, you know, the greater spirit, God source. But I mean, I never use the word God with children, but first it's and foremost, it's just understanding that they are this triad of mind, body, spirit, and what is their spirit and how can they connect to it? How can they nurture it? How can they develop it? And then we expand into connecting to all of the energy around us.
Okay, so I'm gonna do my traditional poke. Obviously, if you've been watching our show, you would expect this coming. But if you haven't been, then I might take you by surprise. I love the body, mind, spirit stuff. Where does the heart fit in? Because that's one of the most damaged. The emotional body mm-hmm. is one that by the time we see the wounds, the damage is done. Mm-hmm. So where does heart come into body, mind, spirit?
It comes in every aspect of the curriculum that I've developed. In fact, the products that I'm developing right now, heart is a part of everything. I mean, you see a heart on every actual product, whether it's a card or a book. Heart is everywhere in the product development itself, and it's everywhere in the curriculum. And the children through learning about their chakras and their heart center and learning how they can send love into the world through from their heart chakra. Heart's in there all over the place.
Okay. Mm. Well, and I would suspect that it would be. I always find it interesting that there is this tendency a lot of times in that which would fall into New Age, metaphysical, the kind of terms that get bantered around, that heart kind of comes in as an underpinning in spirit somewhere instead of a standalone. And you know, somebody who is, you know, I know it's going to be surprising when I say this, but is kind of an emotional guy. you know, I'm not going to say I wear my emotion on my sleeves because my sleeves are too short to hold them all. So I always poke there. I always go, you know, why did you choose to absorb emotions under spirit instead of having it as a standalone?
I just used I just went to the concept of mind, body, spirit.
Okay.
So using that model of mind, body, spirit, I'm only seeing the children being nurtured in two of those three places. Mm-hmm. So I took on the spirit part of that, and heart is just right in there.
Okay.
Yeah, it's right in there as part of it.
So we have a picture on the screen right now.
Mm-hmm.
So this is something that happens at your camp. Can you just share with the viewers for a second? And where is your camp?
I do them all over Maine and New England. I do a different camp I do the camp in a different location every week during the summer. So I have nine camps during the summer in various locations. This is actually one of the opening circles that I do during the course of a day. I'm a shamanic practitioner, so at the very start of the day, we all come together and we call in the spirits of the four directions, north, mm-hmm. south, east, west, then above, below, and within. And this particular group, I have an adorable story to share. This little girl in the pink in the back was 5 years old, and this was the first circle I had done with these children. I explained in detail ahead of time what I was going to be doing, and then gave them their choice of a drum or a rattle to work with me. And then I said, let's sit down and talk about what just happened there. And she raised her hand and she said, my brother died when he was little, and when you were calling in the spirits, he came. He's just right over here. Can he just stay and play with us today? So I said, well, would you like him to stay and play with us today? And she said, yes. I said, if you want him to be here, I would love to have him be here and join us. And that was the start of the first day of spirit camp in one of my very first spirit camps. And that's when I knew this camp was going to be really different.
Absolutely. We, a few weeks ago, had Annette Alford on, who is a medium. And Angie and I both do medium work and talk to spirits as well. But, you know, we talked about that sometimes that ability to connect with spirit is a great healer of grief. You know, from my own childhood, having my grandmother come to me on the night that she died and saying that I still needed her, so she hadn't gone anywhere, left me with this, oh, okay, so Grammy hasn't gone anywhere. Mm-hmm. She's here. She might not be physically here, but she's still here because she came and told me she's still here. So, you know, I wasn't as upset as the adults thought I should be. But I also was like, well, yeah, they're not going to get it. I was about eight. Mm-hmm. By eight, I knew which adults would get it and which ones wouldn't.
Yep.
Do the kids that come to your camp, because of the nature of it, are they more open to spirit and spiritual and psychic and intuitive stuff by nature? Because it's more supported at home, or do you sometimes end up with kids that are just dropped off because somebody thought it would be a good place to drop their kids off?
I've only had that in a few instances, really, where I could tell the child at the beginning of the week didn't have the excitement about being there that some of the other children did. But the curriculum is really fun. So, I mean, by you know, 2 days in, the child was completely fine. Oftentimes, though, the parents have their children come to the camp because the parents understand how important this work is for children. And the parents are very open about this work at home with their child. So that's the reason that they're coming to the camp. In other situations, I have grandparents who are saying, I'm just waking up after all of these years. I know I used to know this information and it got suppressed, and I don't want that to happen to my grandchild. So my daughter or son has given me permission to bring my grandchild to this camp because I want her to be able to stay open.
Now, do the adults come with the children to the camp?
Some parents stay with their children. If the child needs the parent to be there, the parent is welcome to come. I don't discourage parents from staying because I really feel it's important that the parents understand what the kids are learning. So when they go home, the parents can reinforce the teachings. So parents are always welcome whenever I'm working with the children. And the only time I've had a situation where I've had to make a different decision is when the child was so attached to the parent that the child just could not physically detach at all. And the parent just, you know, went out for coffee and the child was completely fine. So most of the time, though, the parents are there kind of on the side watching everything that's going on. And then there are times when it's great for the parents to be able to come in and be a part of. And the kids always love that when they can, like, when they've learned how to check their own chakras and then they want to check their parents' chakras because one of their parents is over on the side watching. It's really exciting to be able to pull them into it.
Now we have, so you have 9 camps. Mm-hmm. We have another picture up. I'm assuming that all the pictures you sent us is a story.
There's a story, yes.
So you want to share the story of this one?
I would love to. I had a young girl who is very, very connected to Mother Nature. She was doing a meditation exercise against a tree where I asked the children to just be very quiet and still and connect with the energy of the tree. I mean, we've done a lot of lead-in work, you know, before this, and to see if there's a message that the tree might have for them. So this young lady, at the end of her exercise, she came up to me and she said, the tree told me it wants me to protect it because it thinks it's going to get blown down in the wind. Now, this was a really big tree she was leaning up against. So, of course, I'm in, you know, looking at her this way and not paying attention to the tree very much. It's just a really big tree. As we were walking away, I turned around and I looked up and the whole top third of the tree was dead and could very well have been blown over in a windstorm. So as I was just walking away, I was just in awe of this child who heard the tree say it needed to be protected because it was going to get blown over in a windstorm. And then the same little girl just repeatedly throughout the week kept showing me how connected she is to nature and to Mother Earth. We were doing a fire ceremony at the end of the week in which the children had learned how to take yucky feelings that they were feeling inside, bring them up through their chakras, and then blow the yucky feeling into a pine cone. And then as part of the fire ceremony, they were going to offer the pine cone to the fire, thank the fire for taking the yucky feeling away from them. And then the smoke was going to be carrying the fire up to spirit. And this little girl just said, I can't do that. I love this pine cone. It's a part of Mother Nature, and I can't put it in that fire. So we came up with an alternative way for her to be able to release the yuckiness from her body, still using the pine cone, but not damaging the pine cone in the process. So there are some really tender hearts that I'm dealing with.
Well, and as you're starting to tell that story, I'm sitting here going, now, did they ask the pine cone's permission? Was the pine cone okay with being there?
Yes, all of that was done ahead of time, yes.
Yeah, you know, had you been around when I was a child, I would have been the perfect child for your program. Like, okay, so there's a few different questions, and I'm not exactly sure, bad host, how many pitchers you brought. Do you remember?
I think
how many?
I only brought four.
Four, okay.
Maybe.
I want to make sure that we get to all of them at some point, but I also want to get some other information out there in the world. So where would be, because, I mean, we air all over different parts of New England and down to New Jersey and now over to, actually, we've jumped over to California. But in New England, this is housed in the Nashua Hudson area. Where would be the closest spirit camp you've got coming up in 2017 to here?
I'm actually looking for space in southern New Hampshire right now. I'm looking in Nashua and Keene, trying to locate a location for a spirit camp here in 2017. So I guess stay tuned and keep looking at my website. And if your listeners have any suggestions of locations, a lot of times I end up booking a location because somebody had said, this sounds like it would be a perfect place for you. Why don't you check it out?
Yeah, that would be, and the email is at the bottom underneath the screen and it will be at the end of it. But it is Eva with an E, E-V-A, at Dancing Jaguar
Inspirations.com.
DancingJaguarInspirations.com. Well, there's certainly some beautiful areas, and if you're looking to do one in this area, now these are just day camps.
Yes.
What requires or what are you looking for? Because I'm sure you would love to hear from my audience, and some people send you emails, but you know, we want to know what some of the parameters are.
Okay. Well, I need an indoor space, an indoor room that's large enough to accommodate the number of children if we have a rainy day, so we can do some work inside. Most of my camps to date have been fairly small because I'm still just growing and expanding the name out there. So usually the camps are 10 children. So I just needed a room like 10 by 20, something like that, with a couple of tables for craft supplies and lunch. Outdoor space for us to do our work in nature. We have one whole day where we dedicate the whole day to working with nature and nature spirits and learning how to connect with nature. So it doesn't have to be like, you know, miles of hiking trails or anything. Just it can be a large lawn with trees and shrubs on the outside edges of it. But if there are any hiking trails available, that's a plus. And then just bathroom and running water. I mean, really, it's not extensive what the needs are. I bring everything with me in my car as I travel.
Okay. Well, we'll talk. Angie, my missing Mrs. Partridge. That's a running joke for a while now. She keeps on disappearing from shows to go help out one of her kids as they're scattering themselves out into the world. So I tease her about being Mrs. Partridge. We are launching a healing center in this area, in the Hudson area, in this winter.
Oh.
So depending on the number of kids you have, that we might be able to make that space available. And it's got a backdoor yard with a couple of acres of land and trees. And actually, my partner and I do a monthly drumming circle. Hmm. And so we've done our drumming circle there several times. So there's a possibility there.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful.
And I'm sure that some other people may come up with some possibilities. So tell me about this young man standing in front of the chakra challenge. I think it says chakra challenge.
Yes, the chakra challenge. This is one of the games that I developed to teach the module on chakras. I actually have three or four different modules that are all about chakras and working with chakras. So in this particular module, I created a game. It's basically pin the tail on the donkey, but the kids have this blank chakra chart on the wall. They're each handed a little round, colored, circular shaped thing that they have to stick up on the chakra chart. And the fun part of this for the kids is by the time they get to this game, they know all their chakras, they know which color goes where, and they understand what each chakra is for. And I use children's language to kind of describe all this. So when it comes time to the game, to do the game, the kids understand that he's going to be all messed up because they're trying to put the they're putting the blindfold on and trying to find the right spot for the chakra colors. And they do understand that it's going to be a mess afterwards. But the joy for them comes in working together as a team to align the chakras of their client. So they love doing this because to them, this is the first client that they have had to deal with who has had an imbalance in their chakra system. So they want to play this game over and over again. And there's a song that I created. It's just a chakra song. But each verse in the song has to do with one of the seven chakras. And it teaches them in there, in each verse is the color, and how that chakra helps them in their lives. So they're singing the song, for instance, for the root chakra. Whenever the child has the red circle that they have to put up on the chart, they'll sing the verse for root chakra. So they're singing songs, they're playing this game, and they're just having a blast being a practitioner working on a client for the first time. And it's just really entertaining for them. So we always have to play this game multiple times.
Ah, yes.
Yes.
Well, and you know, where now, do you ever fall afoul of child labor laws? And you know, you part of advertising this is, and we will return to you a child who you can then rent out as a charm healer.
Well, what's really funny is I have a friend who is an art therapist, and her daughter at 5 years old took one of my chakra classes. Actually, she took spirit camp. That was the first time I had her child in any program. And when her mom would come home from work and had a rough day with clients, her little 5-year-old girl would say, "Mom, why don't I align your chakras before dinner?" So these little kids, they are taking this information in like sponges, and they are using it in their daily lives. On the first day of each camp, they create just out of a cardboard box what they call their spirit toolbox. And in that box, as they learn different tools for self-nurturing, they will put them in their toolbox. So they take that toolbox home with them at the end of spirit camp, and they have their own set of chakra stones, dowsing rods, pendulums, mandalas, affirmation posters that they've made for themselves. I mean, it's just filled with stuff that they have worked with throughout the week. And I've had a mom tell me that when her daughter gets really angry at her siblings and just storms out of, you know, wherever the argument is taking place, she'll go into her bedroom, slam the door, and come out a totally different child in 20 minutes because she went straight to her spirit box, opened it up, and started taking some of the things out of the spirit box. And she knows how to use them. So at 8 years old, this girl was able to shift her own energy. One of the stories that I love sharing with kids is on the first day of camp, we talk about how we're all energy and we're connected to energy around us. And in one of Esther and Jerry Hicks' books, Sarah Book One, they mention, this story is mentioned, where connecting with energy is like working with the plumbing in your house. The water's always there, but in order to get to it, you need to turn the faucets on. So I teach the kids that they have like little faucets all through their body, like the chakras, and when they're feeling really good, and they're happy and everything is flowing, it's because all of their faucets are open and the energy has an even flow in and out of their bodies. And when they're really feeling frustrated, angry, stuck, grumpy, whatever it is, that somewhere in that energy system there's a faucet that's turned off. And my job as their spirit camp teacher is to teach them how to turn their own faucets on so they don't have to wait for an outside influence to affect the way they're feeling. They are empowered to learn and to know what they can do.
Okay. And, you know, obviously, as you heard me say before I brought you on, the whole empowered thing goes right up with the work. And I've, through the years, taught classes like You and Your Psychic Child, for both the parent and the child, and energy, you know, Reiki for children, children's Reiki for children to learn how to do Reiki and things like this. So I think that this is fabulous that you're doing that and that you're making them aware. Mm-hmm. Well, actually, you're supporting their awareness and helping it to mature. Because the awareness is there and we shut it down as a society. Mm-hmm. Through our educational system, through sometimes traditional religious systems, through multi-generational stuff that gets passed on, that, you know, that limits or, you know, fears and all of these things that make this stuff happen. So tell me about this picture.
This picture is on Chakra Day. This is a child, Eve, who is checking Alana's throat chakra to see if Alana's throat chakra is open or closed. And they're learning how to use their chakra stones here. They get a pouch of chakra stones, and they're learning it in this particular photo that they can place a stone on a chakra, and the vibration in the stone will assist the chakra in re-energizing. So Alana has a stone on her heart chakra and on her third eye in this photograph. And you can, in the background, you can see on the floor the little chakra chart that all of the children color, you know, the morning that they're first learning about that. And they learn about the little chakras in the palms of their hands. And if they don't have their chakra stones, they can use their hand to massage in a clockwise direction. To assist the chakra in opening. So they learn, you know, a few different tools to work with.
So now, how long has Spirit Camp been going on?
Three summers.
Three summers.
The first summer, I had two camps. They were both very small. The second year, I had six. Last year, I had eight, and I was invited to Kripalu. Last summer, in August, I presented Spirit Camp at Kripalu, which is the largest retreat center in North America. So I feel like it's on the verge right now of breaking open. And there's a shamanic magazine called Sacred Hoop that is running a story on Spirit Camp in the next issue that's coming out. And that's an international magazine. It's published in Wales, in the UK. So I feel like... It's on the verge of just busting out.
So now we have, so I also want to know, so now your goal is to do nine this summer. Mm-hmm. What is the maximum number of kids that you would do? I know you keep on saying you've kept it kind of small, you know, and this is a building process.
Right. Well, I would have to, when I have 10 children, I have at least one other adult with me. I had a camp where I had 14 children. That was my largest camp last summer, and there were two other adults with me. So I try to keep the ratio of adults to children 5-1, so that there's a lot, because it's all hands-on. I mean, the kids are really busy learning. They're like, you know, just really in the meat of things all the time, learning how to work with these tools, and there's always an adult close by.
Now, would you ever, at any point, is it part of your thought process to actually maybe create some of your graduates as like camp counselors that come back and help?
Yes. Actually, I have junior counselors already.
Okay.
Because I've done one teen camp, but the teen camps are a little harder for me because I can't find a whole group of teens like all together that are really interested in doing this, because by the time a child is a teen in the summer, they're like off playing and doing a lot of
time gets spoken for.
Practicing their independence, yes. So, but I have children that have aged out of camp that still want to be a part of it, so they come back as a junior counselor the next year.
So what is the age of?
Spirit Camp is 5-10.
5-10.
Yes. But I have had junior counselors up to 13 years old that have been there helping. They don't take the place of one of the other adult helpers that I have, but you know, there's always other adults with me, but the junior counselors are there as additional support.
Now, I'm curious, And as my viewers know, I'm a Unitarian Universalist. I've actually had the minister of the local church on a couple of times to kind of educate people more about what UU is. And they have a fairly inclusive, are you familiar with UU?
Okay. Yes.
I would think that talking to their, like I know in Nashua, there's the, it's the White Wings, it's the school. They have an educational program that goes up to, an actual school that goes up to, I believe, middle school. And that might be a connection where you might be able to find that crossover group as well.
Thank you for saying that. I actually did just send a letter to the UU Church in Keene. I didn't know there was one in Nashua, but I will also make contact with the one in Nashua because I have already submitted a proposal for the Keene UU Church.
I would definitely submit one to the Nashua.
Okay.
You know, I would encourage you to go back into the Web of Light archives and watch the couple of shows I've done with the Director of Faith Formation and the minister there, Reverend okay. Allison Palm and Sandra. We're gonna be doing a show this spring. At some point, I'm going to have them on to talk about raising an empowered child. Simply because I find that the UU religious education program is so good because it introduces you to all the world religions.
Yes.
So, you know, it's like, we're going to give you all the facts as we know them, and you get to see where you gravitate towards.
Exactly.
Instead of, this is your way, Darth Vader has spoken.
Yes.
Which is what it feels like sometimes.
Yep, I agree.
Yeah. Okay, so I have something in front of me that says Spirit Camp for Adults.
Yes, I've had so many parents say that they love what their children are learning, but they want it for them too. So I started creating Spirit Camp for Adults. I only have one location for it so far. It's in Waterville, Maine. But hopefully, you know, that will be able to grow in the future as well. But I'm doing the same types of programs that I'm doing with children, the same subject matter, let's say. Obviously, I'm not teaching the adults how to sing chakra songs while they're learning about their chakras. But the curriculum is similar. I just don't use the playful the playful ways of introducing the curriculum. It's much more, you know, adult to adult. Some of the stuff we
okay,
do bring
it,
in.
Okay, that's it then. I want to take the kids' camp.
No, but there is some really
this
fun
adult
stuff.
Crap.
Yeah, there is some really fun stuff that comes into the adult class, though. But in a different way than I do with the kids' class. But the curriculum is similar, and parents now have a way to be able to take their own camp. And it's actually just done in the evenings, one evening a week for 3 months.
Okay. Yeah. So, well, you know, and this is my tendency when I like something or I find something that I enjoy supporting, I'm in the back of my mind going, okay, well, you know, you could really do one in Keene and you could really do one in Nashua. They're really two different areas that draw two different places.
I'm open to it. I'm open to it.
And there are definitely places, some of them which I can contact you with. You know, when you do contact the UU Church here in Nashua and things like this, I'd include the email, the clip of the show.
Okay.
Then they can get a firsthand experience.
That's great.
Of what you're doing. So, Dancing Jaguar Inspirations. Mm-hmm. Tell us about the name.
Okay, the name came because I have had very distinct blocks of time in my life where I have had a specific career, lived in a specific place for 7 years, moved geographically, took on an entire new career. So I have these 7 year cycles in my life. At one point in time, I was a ballet dancer, and then I became the director of a ballet studio in New York. dancing has always been something that I was really passionate about. So dancing just came, it, and kids love dancing. So
yes.
It's very energetic and kids love it. So I just figured that sounded very playful. Jaguar, because of the animal that I work with as a shamanic practitioner. I was introduced to Jaguar many, many, many years ago in a vision. And I just wanted to connect the dancing and the Jaguar together and develop a dancing Jaguar that can, that kids can relate to as the face of this company. And the inspirations is because I want to be an inspiration to children.
Okay, so in the camps that you have coming up, and also to the viewers, mm-hmm. you can meet Eva at the Earth Day Expo. Mm-hmm. She is going to be there at the Web of Light Expo Earth Day weekend at the Courtyard Marriott right here in Nashua, where we're bringing lots and lots of interesting people together like Eva, where you can meet him in person and get more information. At that point, she'll clearly know where I would suspect she's
yes.
teaching one of them or two of them in this area.
Yes.
Or in this greater area, I should say. So I just want to throw that in while we're talking. You have, so tell me, where are the camps that you have scheduled so far? Like just the towns or whatever? We don't need details. They can go to your website for that. But.
Right. Vassalboro, Maine, Wilton, Maine, and Carabasset Valley, Sugarloaf. In
okay.
Maine. Those are the only three so far that are like booked on the calendar under contract. So I'm looking at any opportunities that arise right now. I'm looking for locations. Southern Maine, I'm looking for one, either around York or Kennebunk, somewhere in Southern Maine. I'm not sure. I'm not sure where. I'm totally open to it. And I'd like to do one on coastal Maine. In the Belfast area, Belfast, Ellsworth, over there somewhere.
Okay.
Yep. Can I share a fun story with you about shamanic journeying? I'm a shamanic practitioner, and I love working with my power animal. And I share one whole day of spirit camp is working with power animals, and children learn how to do a journey to discover who their power animal is. And there are some amazing things that happen there. I have one little girl who was afraid to go to sleep at night because she feared she would die in the night. So there was tremendous anxiety in her household about her going to sleep at night. The bedtime routine was just like in a downward spiral. And I'd worked with this child for a little while, so I knew she worked with an owl. And we had made rattles once in one of our classes. So at night, I suggested after the whole bedtime routine was done, that she take her rattle and call in the spirit of her owl and ask her owl to stay at the foot of her bed all night long, watching over her, making sure she was safe, and then ask owl if he would be responsible for waking her up in the morning. That took all the anxiety off her, and she was able to go to sleep at night without having that incredible anxiety that she was living with for so long, that she was going to die in the middle of the night, because she trusted the work that she had been doing with Owl, and that Owl would be there to wake her up in the morning. So there's some really profound stories that I have come across from parents who talk about what this work is doing and impacting their lives as a family. Another boy who has this really interesting power animal story, this is a family that lives in California, so I was doing distance work with this young man. And I did a power animal retrieval for him and brought back the essence of lion. So the mom shared the information with him. And the next day after school, she asked him how school had been. And he said it was fine. And she said, but what about recess? I did not know it when I was asked to do this power animal retrieval for him, but he had been being bullied at school. And the next day after learning he had a lion as a power animal, he said, Mom, recess is fine now. My lion goes to recess with me. And it completely changed something inside him so that his demeanor around the bullies changed. And he became more confident and more empowered. And he was no longer getting bullied.
He was no longer putting out the energy of a victim.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
Exactly. So this work is so powerful for kids.
My my medicine name actually is Wolf Cloud.
Really?
And I got it 23, 24 years ago. But you talk about the power animals, and the shaman that retrieved my name, my medicine name for me, saw me as the white wolf with blue eyes. And I had never really met this man before. I was invited to teach at a Native American men's weekend off the coast of Maine. And the shaman that was running it asked me if I wanted to, you know, have my medicine name retrieved if it was available, if it was available. And, you know, and I was like, sure. And I was like pretty blasé about it. And but when he came back and he said that, I went, and he's kind of looking at me when he's saying this, and he's talking about, you know, Wolf as healer and Wolf Cloud, healer from high and teacher and all of this stuff. And he's like, I feel like there's more than what you're saying. I said, for the last like 2-3 years, I've been appearing in people's dreams and visions as the white wolf with blue eyes.
Wow.
And he had no knowledge of that piece of information. And to this day, when I work with clients, or sometimes people that will come to work with me will say that there was a white wolf with blue eyes before they met me that shows up in their dream, or that has been there protecting them, or children. And the children that I've worked with through the years, if they're having troubles with nightmares or stuff like this, I will always say, you know, I try to empower them with their animals, as you do, but I'll also say, you always know that no matter what goes on, if you look and you see that white wolf blue eyes, you're safe. Nothing can hurt you.
There's a beautiful children's book I just found by Hank Wesselman. Are you familiar with him? Okay, he's written numerous books. It's a takeoff on Little Red Riding Hood. It's called Little Ruth Reddingford, and in it, the wolf is the white wolf with blue eyes.
That's
in the forest, and he is her power animal.
Oh,
and
my.
He protects her from the bullies who are trying to prevent her from getting to her grandmother's house. So
on that note, I am going to thank you for coming as I start to move into to wrap down. Can we pull up her info one more time for me on the screen, since we know that I'm never going to remember it? Eva Goulette is the founder of Dancing Jaguar Inspirations. You can find her at dancingjaguarinspirations.com. Her email is Eva, E-V-A, even though it's pronounced Ava, dancingjaguarinspirations.com. And their mission is, you know, well, we've spent the whole show talking about your mission.
That's true.
And what's going on. But so do contact her. She's looking for someplace in the Keene area, someplace in the Nashua area, someplace in the Portsmouth area.
Yes.
Portsmouth, Southern Maine, to be able to run these camps. I have connections in all those three areas. We'll talk.
Awesome. Thank you. I appreciate that.
See what we can do. And again, Ava's going to be at the Web of Light Expo, Earth Day weekend, April 22nd, 23rd, where she will be showing people and letting you know when those camps are taking place and how to sign your kids up for them, I bet.
Yes, absolutely. I will have the registration forms in my hand.
So make sure you come and visit Eva. Send her if you have some information about a group or an organization or a place that you think would love to have a spirit camp for their children this coming spring, summer, fall, in that time period. Then you can contact Eva directly at, again, that's Eva with an E, E-V-A, at dancingjaguarinspirations.com. And all of this is underneath and at the end. So we're coming into New Year's Eve. And no matter how many New Year's Eve you've had, at a certain age, you learned it was the time to make New Year's resolutions. You resolved to make some kind of changes in your life. You're going to do things differently. You're going to get rid of bad habits. You're going to adopt good habits. You're going to exercise more. You're going to lose weight. You're going to eat better. You're going to get more sleep. You're going to spend more time with your kids. So you're going to spend more time with your parents. You're going to do something. And then January, February, March, maybe 5 days, maybe 3 days, maybe 5 hours, and the resolutions start to get broken. And then next year, you're making many of them all over again. Just stop. Promise yourself this New Year's Eve to be kind to yourself, to learn to love the self that you have for all that you're worth. Discover who that is and what makes you the unique gift from spirit that you are to the world today. And in loving and celebrating and recognizing that person and honoring them on a daily basis, those things which will help you move forward and create and shape the life that your soul came here to have you lead will show up. Those things that are holding you back will fall away. You don't have to make a list to please yourself, to please your spouse, to please your parents, to please your kids, to please your coworkers. You don't have to come in with a laundry list of all your faults and say, I'm going to change this year. Don't change. Discover. Discover who you really are and be 100% that person. And everything else will take care of itself. Namaste.